I'm Jack Rickard.
Richard Flitch.
This is EVTV. Well, now what do we do?
We have a few headlines. Not a lot happened this week, though. It's a after the brouhaha of last week, I think we should follow up with a little interesting stuff from the Tesla. At least let know what New York Times said back, which was John M. Broder of the New York Times journalist defends himself in this piece, basically saying, my account was not a fake. It happened just the way I described it.
What did his boss say?
I don't see his boss in here.
Well, there's another story.
There's another story.
And Kathleen, something or other, of the New York Times said that his story had some problems.
Yeah.
And that it probably could have been handled a little bit better. Meanwhile, CNN, a bunch of Tesla owners and about everybody else on the East Coast have duplicated the drive.
Mm-hmm. I had something on that.
And kind of refuted almost everything he had to say. So it's broken into a brouhaha. Tesla, on Wednesday of this week, announced their earnings. That was a bad surprise to the negative.
I didn't know that.
Analysts were expecting 52 cents. I think they lost 65 cents a share in the fourth quarter. They still have not filed their 10K and 10Q.
Mm-hmm.
It's very odd what's going on. They did say that they had produced and delivered about 2,700 cars in the fourth quarter. And that they're producing them now at a rate of 450 per week.
Mm-hmm.
One of the problems was they spent a lot of money producing that 2,700 because most of their people were working 70 or 80 hours a week.
Mm-hmm.
Now, from 40 to 60 hours, it's time and a half. Over 60, it's double time.
Ooh, and in California, yeah.
And in California, that can tote up. They had a very Merry Christmas. In fact, they all took the week after the first of the year off.
Rest up, okay.
And now they're back producing cars purportedly at a 450 unit rate. There were some interesting things came out of it. For example, they get their tires from Croatia, and it takes 30 days to get here.
That's a long way to go for a tire.
And they're net 30, so they wouldn't pay their bill until they get their tires. So then the company canceled their credit line because they weren't paying net 30.
That sounds, yeah.
And so they wound up behind on tires. Missed a couple shipments. Then they had to fly them over,
ooh,
which was quite expensive. They're heavy.
Yeah.
And so it was the usual comedy of errors. If you think it just happens around here, Richard.
Apparently
it happens.
It's in the EV.
that
makes me feel better. That's the best thing you said.
In California as well. He's having some problems. I think one of the issues, which is part of why the stock is so shorted and why they're having some vendor difficulties, is the vendors and the analysts can't tell Tesla from Coda, from Azure Dynamics, why is one a winner and one a loser?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, they don't have that depth of knowledge to be able to tell.
I can see that, yeah.
And their insistence on selling to OEMs and, of course, giving the best price to the guy who wants to order the most encourages people to talk nonsense about their numbers and how many of them they're going to take. And right now, we have some very butt-sore vendors that make drive shafts, Borg Warner with their e-gear drive, Siemens with their motors, about Azure Dynamics. UQM received $45 million to build a new plant in Longmont.
Mm-hmm.
These are the people Neil Young built a Cadillac, or not a Cadillac, but a Ford.
Mustang or something, wasn't it?
No, it was Lincoln Continental.
Lincoln Continental,
59
okay.
Continental.
Okay.
Using the UQM drivetrain. Well, if you call, they quote you $35,000.
Yeah.
You might be able to talk them down to $25,000. They got a loan of $45 million to move from Frederick, Colorado to Longmont and build a big plant and accelerate their drivetrain development. They sold a few to Audi, who decided they didn't want them. And a bunch to Koda, who was, of course, convincing them to make a Brazilian of them because they would need them.
Mm-hmm.
And then they sold less than 100 cars and are on the way out. Well, looking through UQM's 10Ks and 10Qs and
mm-hmm.
so forth, they took about a $3.8 million haircut on the Koda designated inventory, and now they've got about, they're a publicly traded company, mm-hmm. but they have about $5 million cash left. No real customers.
Not that great looking on the car.
And
yeah.
They're saying, I'm hearing on the street, their probability of being in business past June is dubious.
Yeah.
Understand a lot of the suppliers to Tesla, when Tesla's telling them 20,000 units and
yes.
Audi sells yes. 3,000 cars a year in that price
yes.
range.
I know exactly where you're coming from, yes.
That now they're having to go back and tell them, no, really, we need 20,000
yeah.
of them.
Yeah.
His story is that after a lot of people dropped out with their deposits, I'm one of them.
I saw it. You're not the only one that got dropped by.
No,
Tesla,
I'm not.
By the way.
But there's still 15,000 out there, and they added a net growth of about 2,500 in the fourth quarter. So he's sitting on 15,000 deposits now. He's producing cars at 450 a week. And he's saying they'll be cash flow positive by April. But they
That'd
have
be charging
burnt,
uphill.
They burnt through a bunch of money, and now their mission is to get the production process, now that it's up to the
mm-hmm.
400 a week he had aimed for, to try to get it down to where they're doing that with people working a 40-hour week and without
normal
flying in tires and without, Herculean.
I can give you a couple anecdotes.
Okay, an antidote.
Which is the automobile industry or any of that aftermarket is called hand assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And it means that if, like for me, I had to use the special double eighth inch with a head on it aircraft rivet
mm-hmm.
for these two extrusion applications. If you don't have that one rivet, your entire production shuts down. And some people with hand assembly, if you run out of the lug nut, you can't make the car. And the other thing is, and this is what the suppliers did to me, you would always say, well, how do I get the best price? And their sales mentality is, they'd say, well, you know, if you want that part and you're paying $68 for, you know, if you can get a PO in for $100,000, or for a certain amount of units, well, we'll drop it down to 47. And they kind of drive their business to a high commitment point. And they had a thing called a blanket PO. So I would sign away, and they'd say, within this 90 days, you've got to take all the merchandise. And I think that's what you described.
This is working in reverse. We've had so many companies burn so badly.
Oh, I know.
That they're promising to deliver 20,000,
mm-hmm.
and they're setting up to do 2,500.
Yep.
And you mean you really want 20,000? Okay.
Yeah,
let's do another 2,500.
That's the way it's supposed
and
to work.
You're falling a little behind waiting on us. Well, that's too bad, yeah. buddy, because I'm not going to print 20,000 of them you might buy.
That's right. You're right.
And so it's.
But it is a cart before the horse.
It's kind of an inverted situation. Mm-hmm. And it is interesting. I knew from an early age I didn't want to be in manufacturing. The electric car, you're only going to drive as far as your least cell. In manufacturing cars, if you have every single part in place but one, you still ain't got a car.
That's what I'm saying, yeah. And you figure that out. And then then you've paid everybody else, and the one guy says, well, you know, send me a check, and I'll send you the parts. And you're like, send me the parts, and then I'll sell the cars, and then I'll send you a check. And then you get into this argument, and that's the way it goes. I have been there, so it is not. But anyhow, I had a little bit of connection story here, which this Michael Graham Richard, which does transportation and cars on Treehugger, and you know, he's saying things are really, regardless of what they say, they're still really long term, they're doing better. Mm-hmm. And he does make an interesting quote, and I was going to give this for you. I circled it, which is this a quote from the article. Politics is also a factor. For some reason, partisan hacks have decided to turn hybrids and plug-ins into a symbol rather than just seeing it as a useful technology under development, evolving pros and cons. And it just, you know, they are wanting to come up with information that says this is not working instead of really trying to help us go along. Mm-hmm. And even car makers couldn't be sure how many units they would sell. It's a lot harder to predict those things with new technology.
Absolutely.
So there are some people, I think, that are really seeing it very clearly, and they have some support, and then I think we just have blatant, in-your-face non-support. They just simply are looking for something to say negative, and I can't understand why. I mean, it's not doing anything to them. On to the next topical item. China firms are in line to buy Fisker. I thought so. Have you heard that? Xinjiang Geely Holding and Dongfeng Motor Group.
Dongfeng is largely wrapped up in the government over there. It's got a long decision chain. Mm-hmm. But Geely is probably going to be the purchaser. Fisker has settled their lawsuit with their insurance company, I think, to make this sale happen.
That was in here, yeah.
What is it? XY Group?
XL Insurance wound up in a legal battle over the 338 Karma models destroyed in the storm, washing away $33 million worth of insurance.
I still can't find out what's happened to the 338 Fisker Karmas. The CEO says that they're making sure that they're all shredded so none of them get loose. Why wouldn't he want any of them to get loose?
I don't know. That'd be a good question. That's the guy.
I'd like to pick up a couple cheap.
I would too.
We'll wash them down, repaint them, make them an electric car.
The Fisker is actually a hybrid. That's correct.
It has
some sort of generation.
It wouldn't be when I got done with it.
All electric. But I knew it had something kind of like the Volt in it, doesn't it? Some kind of stuff like that. It looks cool.
It's not very well engineered Volt. But it does have a beautiful body shape.
It has a pretty body. You know,
we can take that, paint it up, put an interior in it, and make it all electric. I think it'd be cool.
Well, that would, it'd be nice to have around here.
Yeah, I think we're just going to go to liquidation auctions pretty much every week.
Send me.
See what
we'll
we
go.
Can pick up.
I have the acronym segment of the story.
Let's go. Let's
which is ARPAE, R&D. What does that mean? DOEARPAE.
Association of Retired Persons.
I'm not making this up. This is why it's such a... Okay, here we go. The DOE is funding the ARPAE, which is Advanced Research Project Agency of Energy, for...
Advanced Research Project Administration.
The agency has issued a funding FOA, which is a funding opportunity announcement. Mm-hmm. For range, RANGE, which is robust, affordable, next generation EV storage. Mm-hmm. So We are acronymically correct now. Department of Energy, though, is going to try to get...
They're still giving away money. Money
to get a lower price, which you had something to do with that.
I worked a deal for a DMOC 845 this week. Let's take a look.
Okay.
I'll tell you a little story.
Okay.
Okay, we're going to divert a little bit from our normal topics. I'm going to show you a little bit of a find I had to do some horse trading for. This is a three-phase inverter, kind of an advanced design, and that's a whole story. This is the DMOC 845. That is a successor to the DMOC 645 from Azure Dynamics. It's the next in the series. This one isn't really quite complete yet, and that was pretty much the case. They didn't really go into production with these, but it's their next generation controller. It's quite a piece of work. A three-phase inverter basically has six switches in it, and the amount of current and voltage that they can switch determines the power of the inverter. The quest for the ultimate insulated gate bipolar transistor, or IGBT, is ongoing, and they're improving them every year quite rapidly. Essentially, each of the three phases has a switch to your positive part of your power supply, your battery pack, and a switch to the negative part. And if you turn on the switch to the positive rail, you'll connect the positive terminal of your battery to the output, which is the point between the two switches, out to your motor windings. If you close that switch and connect the switch to the negative part, you would connect it to the negative terminal of the battery. And so by alternating this, you can have a positive and negative waveform. I suppose it's positive and negative around a midpoint, but that's how you develop a waveform at high currents and high voltages into a motor. The device, as I mentioned, the choice is the insulated gate bipolar transistor, or IGBT. The fad of the moment is the trench gate IGBT. And this is a fascinating module done by Semicron. This is from their Semicron integrated module, or SKIM, and the big one of that is the 93, and that's what we have here, is a SKIM 93. This is basically a set of six IGBTs in one module. The control connections to them are these little spring-loaded pins, which is kind of a cunning design. IGBTs have a lot of problems with the inductance of your conductors to them. The gates act kind of like capacitors. And so you have to turn them on typically with a positive 15 volts and off with a minus 5, although sometimes minus 15. But you want to keep the leads as short as possible. This module is capable of 600 volts. And 899 amps, might as well call it 900. So that would give you a very powerful inverter for a controller. Of course, you want to use less than 600 amps, and less than 900 amps, and less than 600 volts. But it would be a very appropriate size for a very strong 150 or 200 kilowatt inverter for an electric motor. To keep the lead short, basically So Micron urges you to devise a PC board to their specifications with these bare metal lands on them. And these simply make contact with the spring-loaded contactors. And this is your gate driver board. And you put that on there like that. And it's kind of springy. And you use these little screws, which have Torx heads on them for some reason, to screw them down. Another feature, a feature or a problem with IGBTs, is they turn on, and they turn on rather completely. And when you turn them off, you want to turn them off rather completely. And that's so you're not, they're not like a audio transistor. You don't want anything in between, because any resistance in between that is essentially going to cause heat or a loss of efficiency. And so you don't actually want anything in between. Now they do drop, unlike MOSFETs, they will drop a volt and a half, let's say. I don't know if I'm getting these screws in there or not. Maybe not. I have to kind of start from a part and put this together. We're just going to survey what parts are in it, basically. They've done a pretty nice job with this device, which actually causes me quite a bit of anger, which you may not understand, but I'll try to explain it to you at the end. In the event, I'll just put a couple screws on there. You switch the IGBTs rather quickly. The inductance of the leads, of the cables and so forth, is going, when you shut off 300 amps or 400 amps or 600 amps current flow, the inductance of the wires tries to maintain that current flow. And at the point where you shut it off, that will cause the voltage to spike quite dramatically. So you could be running at 300 volts and get a 2,000 volt spike from shutting off a large current flow. Part one of the techniques they use to ameliorate that is to use a snubber. And a snubber is simply a device across your IGBT that doesn't precisely conduct current. It's a buffer. And in this case, we're using some 5 microfarad, I believe, snubber caps with a very high ability to absorb current rather quickly. And so we would call that a very small equivalent series resistance. And so these three capacitors are to try to soften the blow on our IGBT when we shut it off. As I say, the gate driver circuitry, which simply takes logic signals and converts them to plus 15, minus 5 volt drivers for the gate of the IGBT, it'll have some low value of resistance to connect the gate to the emitter, and some other functions because of the voltages of the battery pack. You'll have some high side offset type situation. But normally the inputs are simply digital logic signals. And when they get one to turn it on, they turn it on. And when they get one to turn it off, they turn it off. Those come from your controller board This is the controller board. Here we've got a cable for our encoder and our motor. And here we've got some connections to the rest of the world. This is a current sense board with three Hall effect current sensors. This piece of Mylar here would normally have some copper pieces in it that aren't there, that would come up through the Hall effect to some terminals here. And you've got some temperature sensors here. And this would be the three terminals. This is all on a chill plate. Here's your liquid connections for that. This has a, there's actually a frame that goes down around your board there, your gate driver board. And then this screws into that, but you'll notice this connector seats down on the gate driver board connector. And that is the main electrical connection to between the microcontroller board and the gate driver. The microcontroller in this is a Texas Instruments. It's one of their TMS-470M series, and that's their version of an ARM Cortex-M3 RISC-based microcontroller at about 80 megahertz. It's like a super Arduino or an Arduino Dewey. So this board contains that chip, some interface chips to it, maybe some memory, up to 640K of flash. There's a JTAG connector here somewhere where you can program it. And this is where all the intelligence is. That leaves, almost all controllers have large capacitors. This is a very expensive Sprague SBE, 1200 microfarad, 450 volt cap array. And so you'll have basically six connections for your six switches. And all your capacitors in one big block. To give you an idea of this, just the SCIM 93 module, which is actually SCIM 909 GD066. 066 is 600 volts. The 909 is their 93 millimeter footprint. And 899 amps. That module, I found one online for $2,300. That doesn't include the gate driver board. The development, of course, I'm sure was in their controller board. And this cap set is probably about $1,200. And so this is some very valuable components and would have been a very nice inverter. And why would I be angry over that? Well, I'm angry that I don't have the rest of the pieces and can't put it together and use it. But it goes beyond that. We may have one of the most cunningly corrupt government administrations I've ever heard of. Going back to the administration of Ulysses S. Grant, they have pulled the hugest con job, and they've done it in such a technical fashion that you can't really, you almost can't detect it. These Department of Energy grants and loans that are going so bad in so many directions are almost incomprehensible, even when you know that everyone that got one was a friend of the Barack Obama 2008 campaign, either a contributor or actually worked in the campaign. This particular device is a small enough potatoes example that I finally It erases all doubt, and I get it. In August of 2011, Azure Dynamics got one grant from the U.S. Department of Energy, $5.4 million, to develop a next-generation traction drive system. It wasn't a loan. It didn't have to be repaid. It was to be paid out over 5 years, and I doubt they got the majority of it. All it was the DMOC 845. They got the United States government, the President of the United States, basically, and Stephen Chu with the Department of Energy, to give them $5.4 million to develop the next version of a controller they already had and were competing with in the market. Now, if I was at Curtis and made controllers, and Sevcon and made controllers, and at Reinhardt Motion Systems and made controllers, and at UQM and made controllers, although UQM got $45 million themselves to build a plant in Longmont, Colorado, I think I'd be pretty incensed. We're going to take taxpayer dollars and give it to a company to do the R&D to develop the next version of their product that they use to compete with other companies that don't get that. There's no science here. There's no research here. This is just, here's some money to develop your next inverter that you can use to beat up your competition at UQM and Reinhardt and wherever else. And they're not going to get any. And thanks for your support during the campaign. Just us guys. This is so inherently evil and counterproductive to the future of our economy. I just want to gag. But I have to say that they do have good taste in components. And I wanted to show you what's inside of the DMOC 845 that we're never going to get. I don't believe, but it's possible we'll play around with this and get some ideas. I mean, these components are not at all peculiar to Azure, other than the control board, which is a very ordinary, not even very advanced, ARM Cortex-style multi-controller, very similar to what we're doing with the Machina and the Arduino to drive the 645. It supports CAN and USB and, you know, I mean, it's just a little multi-processor board. They've put it on a board of their design that runs it. They've used a reference design for the gate driver, I'm sure, if they didn't buy the gate driver board from Semicron. And so this is their contribution to it, but all these components are available. They're quite pricey at this point because they're the latest and greatest. But this would make a fantastic controller. Nothing particularly cunning in the mechanical design. It's all just mounted on a chill plate. But I wanted to take it apart and show you the components in it. And you kind of start to get why some of this equipment is a little bit expensive. This is from the integrated circuit manufacturer, Semicron. I've seen these, the 63s probably, for $1,800 list. I found this one online right before we put on the cameras for $2,300, but that's for the module. And there's no point in trying to engineer a module from discrete parts that's going to be better than their integrated power module in this case. They do some interesting things in there. They're sintered. They call it sintered. It's soldered with pure silver, which is at a much higher temperature, about 900 degrees centigrade. That makes it more robust and, of course, lead-free and so forth. for high current applications. It's designed as a module for automotive inverters and motor controllers and generators and so forth. And so it's purpose built for this. If I was going to pick an IGBT to build a charger or a controller or anything, and budget was not a issue, that would be the one. It's the latest and greatest. Again, to keep the lead short, I like their spring-loaded contact directly to a board that sits on top. And the rest of it's pretty ordinary to measure current, snubbers, and capacitors. These are fairly expensive polypropylene film capacitors, which they don't give away, but they last a long time. They don't dry out. They don't have a polarity issue. They're a very good capacitor for this sort of application. And so that's the DMOC 845 we kind of traded for. I had some guys at Reinhardt asking about the internals on the DMOC 645 and 845. This is kind of what's going on in here. None of it a tremendous surprise. It's hard really to do much proprietary outside of the code in your controller board anymore with these kind of designs. After that, it's sort of cunningly arranging current paths and chill plates. That's almost a mechanical issue. So I thought you might want to be aware that this had happened, and it kind of points to the future of inverters, and if the government will give me $6 million, maybe I'll build you one. I would not participate in such. And I think that people that would are heathens and pagans. They're just beyond the pale. Let's all snuffle up to the trough and get ours. And if we can get enough people crowded around that trough, we can pretty much destroy America. And I like it when guys do it on their own nickel, their own time, and do a better one anyway. And you know, somehow it always works out that way. They're always the ones with the good stuff. The guys that got the help and took the short path, I don't know, it just never does quite work out for them. It's part of the symmetry of the universe. Stay with us.
In Solar Reserve, did that anyway influence your decision to give Solar Reserve a loan guarantee?
No. Similarly, I did not
know. Mr. Secretary, did the fact that David Sandilow, Senior Advisor at Good Energy's Assistant Secretary at Department of Energy, major investor in Solar Reserve, did that in any way influence your decision to give Solar Reserve a loan guarantee?
No.
Mr. Secretary, Steve Spinner, whose wife, the law firm, represents Solyndra, a former bundler for the President, Mr. Spinner was. Did that in any way influence your decision to help Solyndra?
No.
Mr. Secretary, how about John Bryson, former chairman of the board at BrightSource, now the Commerce Secretary? Did that in any way influence your decision to give a loan guarantee to BrightSource?
No.
How about Peter Weeks, Mr. Secretary, Clean Energy Advisor at the Department of Energy for loan guarantee programs? Did he have any influence on whether decisions were based on politics, seeing how his experience on his resume says his only experience prior to was working in the presidential campaign?
No.
How about Mr. Secretary Sanjay Waggle, Principal at Vantage Point Venture Partners, investor in BrightSource Energy? Did that in any way influence the Department of Energy's decision to give BrightSource a loan guarantee?
No, it did not.
Mr. Secretary, how about Larry Summers, former director at the National Economic Council at the White House, formerly with D.E. Shaw, an investment firm in with a stake in the Cahuca Project. Did that in any way influence your decision to give a loan guarantee to Cahuca?
No, did not.
How about Steve Wesley, Mr. Secretary, who bundled $500,000 for President Obama in the 2008 campaign? Did that have any influence on your decision to give a $465 million loan guarantee to Tesla, the company that he was involved with?
No, it did not.
Did anyone at the, any of these individuals I mentioned, did they in any way lobby you, talk to you about the respective companies that they had a stake in during the decision-making process with the 1705 program?
And to the best of my knowledge, no. In fact, this is a remarkable list because I was unaware of.
I just mentioned 9 people, Mr. Secretary, if I could, because I have a short time. I just mentioned 9 people representing 8 different companies. My understanding, there were 27 companies in the 1705 program who got a loan guarantee, 8 of which had connections, close connections with the administration, with the campaign. Do you see any kind of pattern? This is approximately 30% of the recipients in the 1705 program, close connections with the White House. Do you see a pattern or concern there?
No, I don't.
You think the American people might see a pattern if 30% of the folks were bundlers for the President, involved the administration, sitting on the boards of the companies who receive money, particularly companies like Cylinder that are now bankrupt? You think the American people might see a pattern?
And, well, if the full record is revealed, I think you can look at some of the other financial backers of some of our loans who were prominent Republican donors. The fact is,
did the White House ever call you about, talk to you about any of these? Did you get someone from the White House, the Chief of Staff, someone from the White House talk to you about these respective companies with involving these individuals?
No, we did not.
So you weren't just helping your friends. You weren't just helping the people who were politically connected to the administration.
That's correct.
Even though 30% of the loan guarantees went to people who had connections with the administration?
Well, as I said, we look at loans on their own merits. We don't look at who's
backing. Okay, so let me turn to that. So if you weren't helping your buddies and you were basing the decisions on the merits of the loan, how do you explain the fact that 23 of the 27 recipients of the loan guarantees were rated as junk status investments? How do you explain that fact? So, I mean, this is what my opening statement was about. If it wasn't your political buddies, it had to be incompetence, because tell me what organization would put money at risk in 23 companies out of 27 that are rated junk category, double B minus. And this is what the American people want to know about, because there's no other conclusion you can reach. You helped your friends or you guys were incompetent. That is the only, when you look at the 1705 program, the facts are the facts. I don't see how anyone can arrive at any other decision.
When you look at the constraints and what we wanted to do with the loan program, which was to invest in innovative technologies, what that means if you're a AAA rated company.
What does junk status mean? Double B minus. What's that mean? Means analysts expect these companies to fail. And yet you put millions of taxpayer dollars, American dollars at risk in companies that S&P and Moody's, they expect to fail, and you put the money at risk. So you're telling me that's what you did, because you didn't base it on your words. You didn't base it on the fact that these were political friends of the White House. So you had to base it on something. And it certainly couldn't have been the investment ratings that they were given by the investment companies, because that indicates that these companies are expected to fail when they're junk status.
Well, first, if you look at the statutes in the loan program, it said that we wanted to invest in innovative projects but had a reasonable chance of repayment.
So,
if you look at the
well, don't you think
the gentleman's time has expired? If you just want to get a final answer,
I would just say, if a reasonable expectation of succeeding, then why did the ratings agencies say that they were junk status, which means they have a problem? They're probably going to fail. That's why they gave them the rating.
The Secretary may answer.
Very briefly, I think we can all look up what these ratings mean. And
I have.
EV rating.
I wish you guys would have before you gave the loans.
The gentleman's time has expired.
Mr. Chairman. Yes, Mr. Chairman, I wouldn't ask. Those are some strong allegations. At least give him a chance to answer.
I am. Okay. That's why I keep saying the gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Secretary, we want to make sure you are fully able to answer a question. Please,
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Thank you for that courtesy. All I just wanted to say is that double B, single B, things of that nature are they're qualitative words. This can be quantified with FCRA ways of dealing with this. And the FCRA rules are saying that you try to assign as best you can. It's an art more than a science.
quite a device.
I know.
Can you imagine the United States government giving people money to develop their products in a competitive environment against their
competitors? I did not know, but I guess.
That's horrible.
Yeah.
And it's exactly, we showed the tape here on EVTV mm-hmm. of them questioning Stephen Chu. Did you know that this recipient was a friend of Michelle Obama? Did you know this recipient was a friend of Barack Obama?
17 of the 23 people are on your list.
Right. Our buddies who were campaign contributors.
Over here you have who knows who, and then over here you have who knows what.
Well,
and then over here who gets the money.
So. But it's just got to be egregious. I think it's terrible what they've done.
I have a solution, though.
What's the solution?
They give us $10 million, and we tell all our viewers, you come up with an inverter that works, I bet we'd get one. We would have thousands of people trying to do it. Do you think so?
Probably.
If you had a mass competition in which people would all work together, I think we would get some answers instead of a company.
We're kind of doing that.
I know. We're doing it the American way. So hang with us and keep on the forum. And
what else happened this week?
Well, something that you've been talking about, which is the wireless system in the pavement, and it is being deployed in South Korea. And they are calling it online electric vehicle, or an OLEV, mm-hmm. and they are putting the coils and the electrical system underneath buses in Korea. And they are going to do it somewhat on a scale. So there's going to be starting of an infrastructure for mm-hmm. The underground charging system, you described.
It's out in the future, but it would, and I mean it's 50 years out in the future, but I mean, it wouldn't have to be. We have several problems that could be solved mm-hmm. With our national grid mm-hmm. backbone. Mm-hmm. If we laid down a conduit mapping our population, it would be about 12 feet from our interstate highway system.
Exactly, that's true. That's actually true. We left the row right down the middle of them, too.
Right, it could all be done to where you drive around on your batteries in town. And if you get low, you go out and drive on the freeway a little bit and recharge. Yeah. And I think that would be a very neat thing. But it's way out there. I think the path more near term is fast charge. I mm-hmm. think the batteries will do it. And I think it's a matter of, imagine, Richard, if electricity was $1 a kilowatt hour.
Okay.
And gasoline is 10 cents a gallon.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody in the country drives electric cars.
Mm-hmm.
And I've invented a little gasoline car that has a 2-gallon tank, no batteries, and it'll run on 20 cents worth of gasoline and go 60 or 70 miles.
Everybody would switch to that. Yeah.
No, they wouldn't, because they couldn't. Where would you go? You have a range problem till you get back to your garage and get more gasoline.
Yeah, okay.
Because there's no place to buy gasoline.
Yeah, there wouldn't be. You're right. That's right.
And so it's really kind of invert the problem and examine it, and it is usually the same problem.
Mm-hmm.
And that's can give you a little bit of clarity of what some of the issues are. But if you walk through that mentally,
mm-hmm.
It comes out about the same way.
Yep. Well, there's not a whole lot. The Dreamliner seems to be scrolling every day, and I just now they're set to offer the plan to fix the Dreamliner battery. They're going to put more space in between the batteries.
Well, that'll do it.
There you go. So that
they need to put more electronics in there, more BMS.
It's still
don't got to have a BMS for the BMS.
There you go. I put it on a video monitor, and then you could watch it. And then if something happens, you would know to shoot some kind of fire extinguisher or something on it. They're going to do that. I just said that. Next mm-hmm. thing you know, they're going to be doing that. The pilot's going to have a little screen in his cockpit, and then if anything happens, he can hit a button.
It's been a cold week.
Yes, it has. We had some bad weather.
Let's go look at the Escalade.
Okay.
See what we can do about warming it up a little bit. Let's go.
Mm-hmm. If you recall, I went to some lengths to describe for you a brilliant concept of using a whole house tankless water heater
that I think was $500 or $600, 24 kilowatt, had these nice copper tanks. We put in a Bosch pump and contactors and all kinds of plumbing. It failed within a week. We burn up both tanks sequentially, and they proved not to be very durable. Hopefully, we have a more durable system now because we've gone to kind of an industrial thing called the hot start. This is the hot start, and it is a hot start is a company up in Spokane, Washington, that has been in business since 1942, and they originally had the patent for engine coolant temperature heaters back in 1942. And all the little block heaters you see since then have been based on that. They've gone on and made quite a company doing very ruggedized versions of a hot water heater for primarily diesel engines, Caterpillar tractors, diesel trucks, trains, and so forth. And it has a very rugged aluminum tank. And what's really, and quite similar to what we had, a basically an immersion hot water heater element. This is what heats your water in your house, in your hot water tank, if you have an electric tank. This particular one, we burn up immediately as well. It was rated for 1,500 watts and 120 volts. Our vehicle, when fully charged, is at 192 volts. Generally, you'll see it at 188 after just a mile or two. But it was sufficient to burn up the 120-volt heating element. So we went to a 2,500-watt, 220-volt element, about 21 ohms, that worked a lot better. And so we've had it in there for 2 weeks. 2,500 watts on the Escalade was insufficient, so we added a second one. But you can get these in 3,000, even up to 4,000 watts from Hot Start. And you can get it in different voltage configurations, 120 volt, 240 volt, 208 volt, three phase, 360 volt, three phase, 420 volt, three phase, and so forth. They have quite an array of basically different heater elements. They also have a number of them with integral pumps and thermostats, but remember, they're based on AC voltage. We're using DC, and it's perfectly okay to do so on our resistive heating element, as long as it's appropriately sized, but it's not particularly good with an AC pump. So we've devised another system. It's working quite well, and I like it. Now, on a large vehicle with lots of creature comforts, such as the Escalade, you're gonna run into some very interesting issues. Basically, the basic system is to heat hot water and send it through your heater core, just as your engine would. The engine always provides basically 195 degree Fahrenheit coolant to the heater core all the time it's running after the first few minutes. Then your heater core, depending on your temperature controls, you'll either route that through the heat exchanger or bypass it. And then in the heat exchanger, you'll extract heat with your fan on a low setting. You'll extract a little bit of heat, and on a high setting, quite a bit of heat. The Cadillac, of course, has a massive heat exchanger, and it has dual temperature controls and a lot of climate functions that are very nice to have. The beauty of this approach is as opposed to the PTC air heaters or something, is you can retain all the creature comforts in a modern car with a modern heating and air conditioning system. They have temperature controls. They bypass the heat exchanger in a variable sense. The fan goes up and down. A lot of it's automatic. You can literally set a temperature and it'll maintain it for you in a modern vehicle. By essentially spoofing that system with heated antifreeze, it's as if there was an engine there. And we need to make zero changes to the system that's in the car, in the cabin, that keeps you warm. The problem with it is a temperature control of the liquid. We have a variable load. As the temperature goes up in the car, the thermostat on your climate control system will start to change the amount of fluid that goes through the heat exchanger and the amount that's bypassed. Your fan will increase in speed and decrease in speed, often quite automatically. And that changes the amount of temperature that's removed from the fluid passing through it. It changes the load on the heating system. And so we need a little bit of a way to control the temperature of the fluid. What we elected to use was, again, a little Chinese meter from the same company where we get the JLD-404. In fact, this is called the JLD-612DC. It's a temperature controller, normally run by 120 volts AC. This version works off a 12-volt DC, which is what we need in the car. And it allows you to set different point temperature to engage or energize and de-energize an internal relay to control a device, an oven or a refrigerator or whatever. You could do this with an air conditioning compressor and make a refrigerator that maintained a certain temperature. Or you could do it with a heating element and make an oven, a kiln for your pottery or something, and it would maintain it. So this is what we use to control the temperature, and this is what we use to heat the device. We do need to be able to circulate the water. I've featured this little pump before on EVTV. I've grown exceptionally fond of it. It's stupidly expensive, about $350. It's got a brass housing. I've shown this before, but I never get tired. DC, and you can set it for different values. Let's see, up to 24 volts, I think. We have it on automatic, I believe, and it works in our vehicle on, we're about 14 volts. This is the pump housing. This is the pump vanes are actually in the side here. And this features some magnets. There is a little needle that sticks up here with a ceramic ball on it. And this device sits on that needle and can twist around different ways. And then we basically have a little three-phase controller of some sort in the housing that rotates the magnetic fields that cause this to spin. So it's not a greatly strong motor, but it has no seals. There's nothing, no connection, but there's no shaft. This is the rotor of the motor, and the stator is in this housing, and it the only bearing is that single point of a ceramic ball that it rides on. And it's built to withstand high temperatures, and this was designed to use in solar hot water heating systems, not photovoltaic panels, but the kind where you put the black plate on the roof and heat water or antifreeze to 180 degrees and then have a heat exchanger in the basement to heat your hot water system. And that's what this pump was developed for. And they do have, indeed, 120-volt AC versions of this. But they also have these DC versions where you can also use a photovoltaic system to power the pump. And we glommed onto these. They work exceptionally well for the kind of work we're doing with cooling systems and heating systems for these components. I put it's a half inch NPT. So on one end, I've put a little AN6 to half inch NPT fitting. And of course, we would normally use our Teflon tape to make that leak proof. And here I've put just a very short half inch NPT nipple. Our connections on the hot start are 1 inch NPT. So I'd take a 1 inch to half inch reducer and then screw this into there. And my pump's actually then mounted on the hot start. The hot start comes with some straps and some plates and so forth to make mounting of it easy. And this one plugs in with a normal plug. The 220 version has a little different plug, but we simply chop it off and use these kind of NEMA 515 plugs electrically. We hose it up with our black nylon braided hose and again some Summit Racing aluminum fittings that are AN6. These are very strong, easy to assemble, and fairly leak proof. I just don't have leaks from this system. And so there we have it. The system starts with a switch that we mount somewhere in the cabin. This is, has a little light, and that's kind of important. You want to be able to tell when your heating system is on or off from the cabin. And all it does is switch a normal automotive relay to apply 12 volts to the back of this. This runs on 12 volts, but and we also route that to the pump to turn the pump on immediately. As soon as you turn on this switch, the pump goes on and begins circulating fluid. We also run 12 volts to the normally closed contacts of relay J1. And we run it through there to the contacts of a contactor. This is a Tyco kilovat contactor. The system we have in the Escalade actually is running about 18 amps at 190 volts. So that's about 3,700 watts between the two of them, even though it's a 2,500 watt element. They're 2,500 watts at 240 volts AC, and we're doing them at 190 volts. So I've got about 3,700 watts of current, about 18 amps total, but it's high voltage. And so we still, on all our heating systems, have used these Tyco kilovac contactors, even though they're 75, 80 bucks more. They're very good about breaking the current and not leaving us connected when we've shut the system off. Automotive relays will arc weld and you think you've shut something off, but you're still applying full battery pack current to your heating element. And so we use a switch to control a relay to power the system, but then we use a relay in our controller to actually operate the contactor on one leg of our pack voltage to the heating element. This is a PT100 probe that we actually offer this temperature controller in the website. In fact, we've got most of this aside from this device. These are for a 3,000 watt, 240 volt. These run about $370 online, is what I've been seeing, brand new. And so you have a handful of
Summit Racing fittings. This is fairly expensive hose. We have a fill tank that we put some AN6 fittings on the bottom of. I actually have drilled a hole in the cap to take this threaded temperature probe. And we take our temperature at the tank, and that's on fluid returned from the heating system. To review that fluid flow, we come out of the bottom. This is a standpipe in here, and this is a hole in the bottom. We run the hole in the bottom to our pump through our heating system. Out the heating system, this fitting here, and note that this does provide a little drain that we can use to crack that and sort of bleed and prime our pump, and which this pump has to kind of be primed to work. And then we go out of our heating tank into our heat exchanger of our automobile, and your fitting there will vary, but you'll have to do some conversion from your little AN6 line up to a larger heater hose, usually with some sort of barb fitting. And then we go through our heater core in our car, and we come back to the standpipe part of this tank. And we take our temperature at the tank, so that's after the temperature drop through the heater core is where we're measuring. I've got our setup. The way you set this up is to press the set button on the front panel, and that'll bring up a display across the bottom, a 0000. You use the right arrow to step across to the last digit, and the up arrow to set a 1 and enter, and that 0001 is the code to get the menu you need to set the temperature controller. And then you will use the down arrow to get the red letters on the top to your AL1, which is your J1 relay. And it's AL for lower, and I set the lower temperature for 140 degrees. And then you press set, you get your list back, and you continue to cycle down with the down arrow to AH1 and press set and enter 155 degrees or whatever your upper temperature you want to be. And then you press set, and then you cycle to the end selection and press set on end, and that takes you back to normal operation. So our 12 volts goes from our switch to our relay, which switches a larger capacity 12 volts to our device. It goes through the normally closed contacts, J1, energizes the relay, applying power to our hot start heating element. And so as soon as I turn this switch on, we begin heating. We also begin circulating. Our pump starts pumping. And we circulate our 50-50 antifreeze water solution through the system. You have to do this for a while when you first install it to get all the air out of it. And it's actually quite a little task, even with a tank that's perfectly capable of forming. And we put this as high as we can in the system, and the pump and the heater as low as we can in the system. But it still takes, I would say, 30 minutes of pumping to get all the air out of one of these heater cores. And you kind of have to work the temperature control up and down and so forth to get it all worked out, all the air. The problem with the air is that it causes this to steam and spume and so forth. Once you get all the air out of it, it's fairly stable. And so as soon as I apply the switch, my relay energizes, goes through the normally closed contacts here, closes my contactor, and I'm heating. When I get to 155 degrees Fahrenheit, as measured in the tank, which is the output of the heat exchanger, after the temperature drop. So we're probably
185, 190 degrees going into the heat exchanger. We drop the temperature and come out at 155. And then that causes J1 to energize. That disconnects the 12 volts from the contactor, which de-energizes and removes the voltage from the heating system. And so our heater core system, our climate system, and the vehicle continues to run, and indeed the fluid continues to, it'll actually climb past the 155 degrees usually, up to, I see, 160 or 165 quite often, and then it'll start to come down. And as we continue to extract heat using that heat exchanger and fan inside the cabin, the temperature will continue to drop. Once it reaches 140 degrees Fahrenheit, I believe someone's calling me on my phone. Once we reach 140 degrees Fahrenheit, J1 de-energizes because our AL1 level we had set at 140, it's going to de-energize that relay again. When it de-energizes, that of course applies the 12 volts to the contactor closes, and we start to heat again. And so our temperature will actually dip below 140 usually, down to around 135 or so. And we'll then reverse as this starts to heat and bring it back up. And the speed with which it cycles between 140 and 155, and these are not set numbers, you can use any numbers you like, you want to experiment with it, is a function of the size of your heat exchanger in there, but also how you're running it. Once your cabin's warmed up, you're going to turn the temperature down to a pleasant 74 and maybe your fan down to low. Now you don't have quite the same temperature drop through there. So your cycle will speed up. There is actually some functions in this JLD612 for PID control, progressive integral derivative algorithms, lead that a little bit and actually learn what it needs to be doing. I don't entirely understand those, and every time I've ever tried to use them for literally anything, I've wound up with a mess. So I very simply do a sort of a wide range thermostat from 140 to 155 or 160 and let it hunt. And that seems to work pretty good. Again, we're drawing about 3.7 kilowatts. If you're keeping track of your 18 amps, if you're keeping track of your kilowatt hour usage, an hour of heating like that is going to take 3.7 kilowatt hours out of your pack. 18 amps would be about 18 amp hours in an hour. We have a 400 amp hour pack. So as I said from the beginning, the objective with the Escalade is to have excellent heating and cooling. And if we can make it actually roll additionally, that would be a good thing. But we're after creature comforts, and we continue to work on heating and cooling. We have not even attacked the air conditioning system yet. We haven't actually hooked it up. We have a new fan in the front of the vehicle, but we're using the original condenser and evaporator and compressor from the vehicle, with all the same ECU-type controls to it. So the main differences, we're going to have Earl down at Earl's Radiator Shop extend our hoses, and I would expect he won't even make up new hoses. He'll just cut them and put in a plug, a little piece with a coupler on it to extend those hoses where they'll reach the compressor now in its new position, and the condenser, and charge the system.
and we should have air conditioning. But the heat, we've tried several things, and this is the latest. This seems to be working after about 2 weeks, and it is quite cool here. It does not feel like the system that it was in the Cadillac, actually. I set it to like 90 degrees and let it heat up, and then I'll put on the automatic system. This 3.7 kilowatts is not actually enough. I would like to be at 5,000 watts. And actually, these elements are interchangeable on these hot stocks. You can get other elements. They're replaceable. And so I've got this tank. We can get another system, another element system in here, and change this to a... I think I saw a 4,000 watt, 220 volt element. And we simply get this part. And by simply, they're a couple hundred bucks, actually. It's almost as cheap to get another hot stock. And certainly if you're getting them on eBay, and replace this. And so I intend to up the power somewhat on the two of them that I have mounted underneath the truck. So far it's drip free and it's coming on reliably. We're not burning up any more elements and we get quite good heat into the system. And so we're gonna keep after that and continue to play with our controller and with our heating elements until I get it to work as closely as possible, like the original vehicle. But I'm toasty warm at this point within just a few minutes of getting into the truck. So I'm pretty pleased with it. And I think this is the way to go simply because it's mountable. And it's we mounted it under the front bumper of the truck. This does not take up near as much space as this, for one thing. And that grossly shortened our cable links, our tubing links. And that, in turn, kind of helped our temperature control. There wasn't as much of a delay in the system with all that fluid strung along those longer hoses. So by moving it up forward under the front bumper, this had a pretty good effect on the whole system. So that's our latest heating system efforts. I can't guarantee you we won't change it all again, but right now it seems to be working quite well. I have to say, I think we're offering this at 112. These tanks are about 100 bucks. This is about $75. This is 350. This is 368. These run between 5 and 10 bucks a piece. These are 5, 6 bucks a foot. You can get 1,000 bucks in this real quick. It's just kind of part of the game. But for me, the liquid heating system, leaving the environmentals in the vehicle intact, is absolutely the way to go. Now, if you have an older vehicle or a VW type thing that never did have any heat, those PTC heaters are ideal. But when you have a climate control system in the vehicle already, and particularly the more modern vehicles, the less you can do to that and fool with it, the better off you're going to be. Again, this is the latest version, and we'll keep you apprised of our progress. But right now, I'm very pleased with it. It's very securely mounted to kind of a crossbar in the front end of the vehicle. It's very rugged, and I can get replacement parts for it. And this company's been around forever. I can get another heating element and just bolt it on if I did burn them out. But we seem to have gotten the right combination of voltage and element. Now, this 120 volt element, if you're doing a 140 or 150 volt system, that would probably work. But we clearly burnt one up here, and it simply wouldn't heat any longer. And so I will probably get another element and
save this because, I mean, there's nothing to break here. I mean, this is a very rugged system, but there's no break to it. It does have a little check valve in this end, which is sort of interesting. So they are a bit directional, but we put the pump going into the device, and so that works just fine. And take our output out here. And it's some adapters to get your NPT from this very large 1 inch down to, we use a half inch NPT, but we're ultimately going to 6AN hose. And I can watch the flow in the tank and the way the system operates, and this AN6 is plenty of diameter. We get great flow through the whole system. This pump is a stallion, and so we're moving the fluid through quite briskly and moving quite a bit of heat. The same concept is our cooling, and we replace the heating element with a heat exchanger, and we've got a cooling system for our DMOC 645 and our motor from Siemens. Oddly, and I do recommend this pump, but we'll call it $59. I've got 159 of the pumps from the Azure Dynamics thing, and we'll have those up on the thing. I'm sure they'll do just as well. They won't have the life this one does, and I mean, this is a very efficient pump. One of the things I like about it is it's totally silent. You have to put a finger on it to tell if it's turning. And you have to see some fluid out the other end to tell if it's pumping. And it does have to be primed to get started, but it's a fantastic pump. It's just a little bit pricey. And so that's our take on the current heating system du jour of the Cadillac electric Escalade EXT. I have to tell you that I just get a kick out of going down the road at 8,000 pounds, electric with an 80-mile range, and it floats on the interstate at 70, 75, as if you're walking. It's just, and I got my radio, I got my air conditioner, I got my heater, I got my GPS, it's my heated seats, radiant heated seats, and it's, I've got too much money in this car, and I've got too much time in this car, but I love this car. And it is so much more me than a Model S sedan. I just don't think you can quite picture it. It's just what a big fat guy needs to ride around town in. Stay with us. So, that's pretty high tech, using 1942 technology.
I know. And you know who I talked to, a local? Hudson down there with the Jeeps.
With the Jeeps?
You remember the little Jeep guy? That they can't, these older restored Jeeps. So he thought it was a wonderful idea. Uh-huh. And so that name and just that technology, there are some people that have knowledge of it around.
The Hot around Start.
The Hot Start. Yeah,
it's been around since 1942.
Yeah. I thought it was
We'll try it. It's working well. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work like a Cadillac. In other words, you normally just set the temperature in there and it mm-hmm. all runs mm-hmm. automatically. To get enough heat out of it, I've got to crank it up to 90 and then turn the fan down a little bit so it mm-hmm. can build up mm-hmm. to the maximum temperature, and then I can crank up the fan, and I'm warm, I'm toasty. Mm-hmm. It'll blow in the windshield, blow down on my feet, but it doesn't work like an automatic.
How about defrosting? Have you tried defrosting?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No, you okay? That's what I always heard I thought they were using like backhoes and caterpillars and stuff.
Yes.
That's what I thought.
Trains okay. And caterpillars and diesel trucks. And
stuff. Yeah.
No, it's can plug it in, and it will warm your engine coolant
up north
in poor climates, and then your diesel typically are hard to start.
That's my favorite Minneapolis story. I went up there and I'm like, what are all these little things on the poles? And they're like, those are heaters you put in the car so it doesn't freeze. Uh-huh. I'm like, I don't think I need to go back down south. This might be a little too far north.
This might be a little too far north. No, that's what they are. But I went to it because it's more industrial strength, but we still burn up a element trying to run 188 volts through 120 volt. The AC is AC, but the average, or actually the RMS value, is 120. You can exceed that, but you can't do 200 volts, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
You can also get different elements. So, and that's what I like about this product. I can unscrew the end of it and plug a new element in. Now, they're a couple $100, and this is for a heating element that down at the hardware store is $8.
Yeah.
They have replacement elements, so I could swap out a $2,500 for a $3,500 or something. And you can go up to about 4,000 watts in one of those at 220.
My immediate feedback was it's a rugged heater, and that is a, change of temperature. It's got vibration. It looked tough. So I think we put a stamp on that one for...
Test.
We'll eliminate what doesn't work. That's part of our job here.
Right. This is another thing we're going to try, and it may work, it may not.
Yes. I got it.
But we'll keep after it. I'm hesitant to declare victory. This heating is a more complicated thing than I thought.
Mm-hmm.
For one thing, if you turn down the heat, but you have the heater on, it builds temperature very quickly because... It's a huge heat drop through that heat exchanger. Yeah. If you turn down the temperature, it bypasses.
Okay.
So you've got a valve bypassing the liquid.
I knew that.
And then you have the amount of heat you're taking out with the fan. And those are interactive. And that becomes interactive with your controller, whatever it is. Whether it's a little bimetallic thermostat or, as we've got now, a little digital controller. And then, of course, all that plays back and forth with your ambient temperature. If it's 10 degrees out, that's different than at 50.
Mm-hmm.
They all sort of play together, and it's kind of a balancing act to get all that to work out. There was an interesting report this week, and I will try to get these graphs and stuff and put them up on the blog probably.
Okay.
Argonne National Labs.
The big boys.
Yeah, took a leaf. And they put it on a dynamometer. But this was a dynamometer where they could run the EPA driving cycle test, and there's a US 006, which is a harder driving cycle test, and so forth. But they could do it at different temperatures. Now, I like this kind of testing. This is the whole car on a dyno in a temperature. We're not guessing.
Mm-hmm.
We're not testing batteries in the lab and using that as a model to project. We're going to put the car in a room.
Mm-hmm.
And on the hot end at 50 degrees centigrade, we're going to have heat lamps like the sun.
Mm-hmm. That's what I when I saw product testing, you would... Yeah, they put heat lamps out and they block stuff up in a box and stuff, yeah.
Right, so that's they right. did this at different temperatures and measured the range. And at minus 20 degrees, the leaf had a range of like 46 miles. And under the best conditions, 90 miles. And then with the air conditioner on. And the air conditioner was not as big a load as I thought. It was much better than the heat. But
electric pump,
you lose some battery because of the temperature, but mostly what they were measuring was your use of heat and air conditioning. Mm-hmm. What I liked about the test is that it included the heat and air conditioning. What I didn't like about the test was that it included the heat and air conditioning.
Yeah. So I wonder how long
I wish they would do it just on the batteries with no heat and air conditioning.
Yeah.
and then do it with the heat and air conditioning, and that way you can actually get how much of it's going to heat, how much of it's going to air conditioning, and how much of it is with batteries. But it was a very, very good test and a very interesting test. And we'll put those graphs up on the blog. What else did we do this week? The Ford Edge, let's talk about batteries. I'm attempting battery suicide back there. And doing something you should never do with an electric car. But I'm going to try to experiment with it and see what I can get away with here. We're going to find the limits of what you can do mixing different batteries in a series.
Wait a minute. You skimmed by that one. That's a little fast for that conversation. Mixing?
Yeah, we're going to take some 90 amp hour cells that are lithium iron phosphate. And put them with some 100 amp hour cells that are lithium yttrium iron phosphate, and they're not even the same size. They're 100 amp hour, and we're going to put them all in a series string, and bottom balance them, and then
charge them up,
see if we can make the car go without killing anybody.
And then you say, Richard, would you guys stand over here?
Yeah, right. You guys stand.
Jack, here's the keys.
Let's take a look. Just a quick update on the Edge. We kind of threw together a mess of a battery pack and tried to see if we could get this thing running, and we did. And in fact, we lost a couple cells. Because I didn't do what's in our cell care PDF, bottom balance of cells, and worse, I've committed some sins against this poor vehicle. And it looks like I'm gonna keep them. We had two packs of 75 cells. One of them were these ancient, out of our original Speedster, 90 amp hour, kind of fat cells that were lithium iron phosphate. They were actually the first cells I bought from ThunderSky. I bought them from Elite Power Solutions out in Phoenix in 2008. And that was one 75 cell pack. And then we had 75 cells that were in the vehicle. There were some later, actually smaller, thinner cells that were 100 amp hours, and they were the lithium yttrium, LYP, they called it, chemistry, and quite a bit of an improvement. Believe it or not, it's not too much of a problem to have completely different kinds of batteries if they're in parallel. One of them may draw down a little faster than the other one, but then when you pull up the stoplight, the other pack will charge it back up. The cells are in parallel anyway. Inside the cell is 400 parallel cells. And so it's fairly forgiving of a parallel situation. As long as you have the same voltage on each pack, same number of cells, and roughly the same chemistry. But you can mix them somewhat parallel. And we did that in this car. It was very heavy with batteries. We've used a lot of those batteries in our test bench now and lightened the vehicle quite a bit. And the big problem was the original build had 48 of them up under the hood, 400 or 500 pounds of cells. But worse, you couldn't get to anything underneath it. We couldn't even check the transmission fluid. And so we removed those. We still have a pack of 28 underneath. And in fact, I've got 2, 4, 6, 8 of the little cells up here and the other 66 of them are the fat cells, the 90s. Now that's a problem. We're putting cells in series now. We put them all together in series, but they're not the same size cell, and they're really not even the same chemistry. Are we going to get a good outcome of this? Probably not. On the other hand, my wife likes the car, and she drives about a mile and a half to the university, about 2 miles over to Walmart, another mile to get her hair done, and usually back home. So a 20-mile range would probably be overkill if I can cobble this together somehow where it'll last for a while. What we're going to do is what we always do, and that's bottom balance all the cells, and then we're going to undercharge it. Unfortunately, since they're different sizes and different chemistries, we're going to have to kind of way undercharge it in order to get away with this. So we're going to bottom balance all these cells here. All the pack underneath is very difficult to get to. They're all the same cells. I'm going to set them at the voltage where they would be 2.75 volts and pray. I think they were bottom balanced before, but 28 times 2.75 would be 77 volts. So we'll trim that up for 77 volts, set all these at 2.75, and then I'm going to spot a couple multimeters in here where I think we're going to have a high spot, and we're going to charge it until that cell gets to 2.65 volts. And that's as fully charged as this pack's ever going to get. We may have a 20-mile range, but I think then if we can set the charger for that, this is kind of like lining up a whole bunch of glasses in your kitchen. Some of them are shot glasses and some of them are iced tea tumblers. If they all start out at exactly empty and you take the smallest glass you've got and fill it up just not quite full, and then put the same amount in all the other glasses, you're going to have some iced tea tumblers with half the glass empty. But the water level is going to be equal across the glasses. And so then when you drain them down, they should all get to be empty at the same time, and none of them hurt each other. And if you refill them to exactly that same amount, it ought to all work out. That said, I do not recommend this procedure of mixing different chemistry and worse, different size cells. You'll have your best luck with your automotive power pack if you'll try to get as closely matched a set of cells as you can at obviously at the same chemistry, but ideally manufactured at the same time and as close as you possibly can at the thing. We do have, of course, our RevoElectric device to do this, but I'm still kind of old school. I've got my Fluke. This is a Vishay power resistor. It's 250 watts. It's 0.1 ohm. That's about 30 amps on a 3-volt cell. And I've got some clips that are getting pretty chewed up from all the sparking. And I just go through and put it on the terminals and bleed them down. We drove the car till it was quite low. Then we ran the heater till they were down around 3 volts. Actually down around 2.7, 2.8, and then turned off the heater. Now these cells, they bounce. When I draw this down, and they bounce differently between the LYP and the LFP cells, I'll draw it down to maybe 2.5 or 2.6 volts, and then it recovers, and it very quickly bounces up, and then it slowly counts up another good bit. It takes overnight to get the cell to a static level. This is one of the problems I have with the whole top balancing scheme. If they're trying to do something, they're taking a recipe for charging a battery and a reading messages from God in cloud formations there. They're trying to infer that that is the state of charge of the cell. There's a lot of diffusion delays, stuff that goes on inside of these cells. When you're putting current in them, you don't really know what they are. Similarly, when we're taking it out, we don't. But on the bottom balance end, we take out a little bit and it'll recover in just a few minutes. And we'll take out a little bit. We're not really doing it under a current situation. We're at the other end of the charge-discharge cycle. Both ends are very steep, but the only way to access the charge end is by charging. The discharge end, we can stop, let it rest overnight, and that is the open circuit value of the cell. We can't do that on the charge end. where the steep side of the charge curve is actually while you're pumping current into it. And so John Hardy's done some nice work graphing what happens. And what they're trying to do, balancing those, I'm not even sure that that's what they're doing. I think they're yanking these cells around. Rich Redmond said something that kind of keyed me. He said that every time he charges, he gets a lot of current in balancing. Well, these cells don't act like that. If you balance them, they pretty much stay there. Why does he get current every time? I think it's because there's nothing really getting balanced. He's playing with the diffusion into that anode during what is a procedure, a recipe, to charge the cell. And the voltage is not really that indicative of the state of charge. It's indicative of the state of the diffusion at the end of the charge. And that's where they diverge so much. And so looking at John Hardy's graphs, I've become convinced that that they're not even doing what they're telling you they're doing or what they think they're doing. And the only place you can accurately measure these cells is in a static sense. And the only place where the differences in voltage make sense is on the steep part of the discharge curve at the end of discharge. And as one of the BMS guys told me, well, that would make sense, but it would be very inconvenient to balance at the bottom. And as I told him, you know, in all this time, and I do love these cells, and I think they have some affection for me, they've never asked me once what I would find convenient. And I have to confess that I've never really asked them what they would find convenient either. It's just not a guy kind of thing. That's sort of girl talk. You know, we don't really have feelings, me and the cells. We have electric cars. And so what's convenient and what's not, they're curiously unconcerned. And so I'm left to bottom balance with my little resistor and my multimeter. And that's what I'm going to do now. However, my opportunity for success from the get-go is somewhat limited in that I'm using different size cells and they're a different chemistry, all in a series pack. Not recommended. I'll hobble along a couple of miles at a time, but this is not the way to take care of your cells. It's a way to take care of them. It's not the cells to be taken care of. But this vehicle, I just don't care enough about it to invest a whole new pack of nice CALB CA series cells. So we're using our used cells and our rejects, and don't mention that to her, okay? So that's that.
That, by the way, that's been my, I've had that question before, so I hope it answers it.
You can certainly parallel different types of battery. Okay. On the Speedster Light, I'm probably going to haul out our platinum pack of A123s.
I've been wondering about that.
And put them in parallel with a string of 40 or 60 amp
hour. Okay, light bulb just went off. Got it. Okay.
And that will let me put out a lot of current quick and still have some range.
I think that will be very interesting for the viewers. I think they want to see some of that, and I hope what they saw about the Edge helps them some.
I will probably, in the case of the Speedster Light, actually put in dual JLD 404s so we can see how much is used out of each.
I want to know. Now that, and so forth. I'm interested in seeing.
So
I'd like to hang around and see that.
That'll be kind of interesting process. What else do we have going? The VW thing. I have a new transmission. It's an IRS transmission. They tried to put it in this week, and the drive shafts wouldn't fit. As it turns out, the thing uses 100 millimeter couplers,
mm-hmm,
and the 6 bolt, and the VW uses 90.
90, that's about
And so it was, they wouldn't actually hook up. I'm not even sure how to solve that.
that's the thing. What is that? Where's the old transmission, by the way? I forgot to ask that.
We put it back in the car.
You did?
Uh-huh.
Okay. It just goes really slow is the problem with that transmission. Is that correct? It's geared very low. I could never tell why it drove so slow.
I never can work out high and low on gearing.
I never can either. That's maybe a viewer can help
to me, low gear is that, you know, the engine spins a lot, but you don't go very far.
And the power, like going uphill.
And we need a higher gearing.
That's what I thought. So.
For an electric motor.
Yep. Make that thing go.
So the thing is like a 4.37 ring and pinion, and I put a 288 in this one.
That's the line of the week, by the way.
What's that?
What's Jack's new thing? And it's working on the thing. See? We're working on the thing, then we're saying the truth. So.
We had actually a very successful electric vehicle conversion convention last September, and I declined to take reservations for the next one at that event. Mm-hmm. And we have been talking to some of the vendors and some of the attendees about ways to make it better, make it different, or do something. I guess we're about ready to announce it. I'm working with Chris Fisher to try to get our registration database lined up.
Wait.
To open the 1st of March for registration for the Electric Vehicle Conversion Convention for 2013. Richard has found us an alternate venue, the AC Braze Arena. This is actually belongs to the city of Cape Girardeau. My uncle, two uncles actually helped build that in the 40s.
Yes, I know it's an old building.
It's an old building.
It's seasoned, though. It has a certain seasoning to it.
Well, and it used to be, the irony is, it used to be on a racetrack.
I know.
And they took up the racetrack and built a bunch of Little League baseball fields. It's just...
I played there.
Awful. I want the track back.
Yeah.
But the arena building is not as big as the Show Me Center, but it has a lot of character, and it's actually in a park, like Cap Hall Park, where we were having the car show.
Lots of extra
this
room.
Has got that kind of venue. It's much closer to the hotels. And the dates that we were able to get it for are a little...
Earlier in the year.
They are. We're going to schedule this for August 7th, Tuesday, to the 11th, Sunday. That's a day longer, and that's because Friday, when we do the half day down at the airport, we're going to do all day down
there. That's what I was actually, that was
a lot of guys.
Everybody wanted that. I'd rather have a whole day down there and just get out some lawn chairs and do the thing.
We'll have our scales. We'll have the guy back with the dynamometer on the truck. That was very popular, but not really till the end of the day, really in the night.
And it was night, yeah.
And then all of a sudden, everybody's like...
They understood what was going on because you couldn't test a lot of these parameters.
What I want to do with that is we're going to assemble a panel.
Yes, that's what we need, yes.
I'm going to be on the panel and a couple other people.
That's what you need.
John Metrick has to be because it's his idea, actually. Mm-hmm.
You need more judges. That's exactly right.
No, this is going to be a panel. Okay. This is going to be a guess your weight panel.
Okay.
See how much the fat chick weighs.
Okay.
No, it's going to be a talk to the owner a little bit about what he's got in the car and take a look at it. And we're all going to write down a number of what we think the horsepower is going to come in at.
What was the high end last year? We got a couple of 350.
Oh, yeah.
The 390 or something.
I think Seb was up around 360 with his
357, horses. I think, was a pretty powerful number.
Yeah, there was some pretty neat things going on there. And then, of course, Jason Horak burst into flames on the dynamometer, as I recall.
Sparks. There was a lot of sparks.
A fireball came out from underneath. But the dyno was a lot of fun.
And we got video. So.
We'll have the autocross people come back and do that.
Okay.
Probably do an eighth mile instead of a quarter mile. I'm told that it's just...
turns around quicker, guys run through, and a little bit safer.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I think we'll be okay with
that.
So
we'll do an eighth mile drag race.
We've got all the equipment. So.
And we've got the drag race equipment. But we'll have it at AC Braves Arena. The registration is going to be $5.95 again. No
okay.
change.
I remember that. Okay. Let me write that down.
We're going to discount that till May 31st for early registrations
okay.
to $400.
Okay.
The thing with the cars and the vehicles has kind of been problematic. I'm going to tighten that up a little bit this year. It's for lithium automobiles and trucks.
Okay.
That you have converted from internal combustion. Now, if you want to bring a lead-acid electric car and display it, come ahead.
Okay, I'll be fine. Okay.
If you want to bring a homologated OEM, show off your Tesla Model S or your Roadster or your Fisker or your Leaf, God love you bringing it. Bring it too. I'm not paying for it, but you can bring
it. That's right. Okay. That sounds good.
We're going to
focus on the people that are doing this.
We're going to offer a discount to people who have converted themselves a vehicle mm-hmm. from mm-hmm. gasoline to electric and, okay. and using lithium ionic batteries.
Okay.
And we're going to call them co-hosts.
Okay.
I thought about sending each of them a bill for how much I was out after the last EVCON, but that's probably not. That would cut it down.
We could divide it, but it would only be.
And I want you to get them like separate shirt. Really, these guys are part of the show. This is
okay.
why we discount it. Is
Absolutely.
They're answering questions from people who would like to build cars.
Co-host.
So I want you to have a different colored T-shirt.
Got it.
For our co-hosts
different.
Who are helping essentially to put this on and going through some daunting logistics to do so.
Mm-hmm. We appreciate all it can.
And they should be recognized a little bit more for that. And that way, our attendees that didn't bring such a car can easily identify them and tag them for questions.
That's the way to do it. That's and, why you come to these events. You better believe it. When I'm back in my day in the hot rod,
I want you to work out a color code scheme for shirts.
Perfect.
For our co-hostages.
Okay. Co-hostages. Okay.
And they can register at $99.
Color code scheme. Okay. That sounds good to me.
The guy who swung me over, Nick Smith from New Zealand.
And
Nick was the first to register for the first electric vehicle conversion convention. Oh, you got your New Zealand cap.
That's the hat he gave me, yeah.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
He was also the first to register for the second
there you go,
electric
Nick
vehicle
Smith.
Conversion
Well, it was opportune to wear
he
this.
He comes a very long ways. He was quite insistent that I have it this year. And he even offered to speak. So as far as I'm concerned, Nick Smith of New Zealand is our keynote speaker.
There you go.
And I want to introduce him on the first morning. And I want to hear his story of how he got involved with electric vehicles and what he's doing in New Zealand and what the state of New Zealand electric vehicles are.
That sounds good to me. I think that'll be a topical discussion.
And he's going to be my keynote speaker.
Amen.
And so far we got me and we got him.
That's a start.
Speakers, by the way, are waived completely, Nick. You can go ahead and register, but you don't have to pay anything. And anybody else who thinks they might want to present and can make a cogent case for a fascinating topic delivered
there we go.
Like George will. I'm all ears and would love to hear from you, jack@evtv.me, what you would want to present on. We're going to try to put it together. So Tuesday evening's reception, we'll have sessions on Wednesday and Thursday. Play day on Friday.
Yes!
Saturday, we're going to have sessions again in our car show.
Okay.
And that should give you time to put together something a little more organized on our awards and so forth.
Bigger trophies.
Saturday evening.
I'm going to get bigger trophies. And more trophies. Of them. How does okay. that sound?
All right.
Bigger and better, more trophies.
Well, now here's what you can't do, Richard. We okay. can't have a cattle call that goes on for hours and that you get all confused and get the wrong guys the right trophies and that sort of thing. We've got to get you some help on that.
I know. I always need help.
And you're going to have to break off it. And you did pretty good having the judges do the judging
I will, the builds. The car show build was done by people who had mm-hmm. car judged before.
So. We're going to have people designated to
for everything.
Keep the records at the drag race, for mm-hmm. example, mm-hmm. the records at the autocross.
The autocross. The weights, there's going to be a lot more. We'll have a much
Again,
better plan.
Again, bring any electric vehicle. Mm-hmm. We're going to subsidize the conversions with lithium batteries.
Sounds good to me.
And but you'll be able to weigh your vehicle. You'll be able to get a dynamometer test. You'll be able to see other guys' vehicles, talk to them. It really is kind of an interactive
it's
type
the,
thing.
It's
And then,
what's
of course,
building the business.
We have quite a bit right here at the shop
mm-hmm.
With we have putting broken vehicles up on the lift yeah. and working on them and so forth. And,
you're like, man, I got.
Again, I've been starting this on Wednesday. Monday morning, they start showing yeah. up. So let's just move it back to Tuesday.
And, I think last year you left about 3 or 4, and I showed up about 6. I remember I showed up about 6:20 down here, and they were still here.
There are some developments I'm watching. In university and government laboratories by some people that I would like to have come talk to us.
Okay.
I don't think I can get them to come in October or September because mm-hmm. they are at a university. Might have a shot in the second
yeah.
week of August. Now here's the downside. Cape Girardeau, Missouri is a holy hell in the summer. July, I don't even go outdoors.
Humid. It can be humid.
And it can be hot.
Yeah.
Now, I always say if we can make it till the 15th of August, we made it.
We made it, yep.
And sometimes we get a break at August 1st.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm. We might.
But there's a possibility this could be very warm.
I like it right then, so I don't know. I don't
think
problem.
AC Breeze is air conditioned anyway.
You know what I say?
And it's a very shady park-like
it is, yeah.
Area.
That's that's another thing the car guys will like. They can move their cars around, kind of keep them in
Yeah, shape. There's a lot of room outside yeah. and parking and
it'll be a more festive
and so forth. And ways to do photos.
The summer, I think, for the car shows and that general theme, people kind of like that, and they're have had multiple car shows there, so it'll be fun. I like the dates. I'm all in. So
okay.
We're doing good.
Well, you like the dates because you came up with them.
I know. I picked them. I like 7-Eleven. See, remember 7-Elevens and stuff? It just goes together.
I had a convention in Tampa in August in 1994 or 1995. It was a disaster. So I've been a little careful with that since then.
Well, let's go.
They actually gave us the Tampa Convention Center if we would just bring people to Tampa and put them in the hotels.
Yeah.
And this is a gorgeous convention center. Enormous thing. We had a lot of vendors that year. And they all come in 18-wheel trucks, and they actually drive right into the on the mm-hmm. convention floor and unload all their stuff. And so we had a certain load-in time, and everybody did that and got all their stuff in. And they closed the doors and turned on the air conditioners while these guys are setting up their electronic equipment. It rained for 45 minutes.
I can imagine. Yeah.
And I don't mean that it sprinkled. This is like having a thunderstorm indoors.
Yeah, I can imagine.
There was no lightning, but it rained solidly for 45 minutes on these guys' electrical equipment because the cold air, the air conditioner, hit that moist, humid mm-hmm. Florida air, and it just fell out of the air, and it was an enormous facility. I've never gotten over it.
Man. I'm telling you, That,
but we'll try August.
You know what I say?
7th to 11th, that's right in the period where it usually.
Pretty decent. I think it's going to be okay. And the guys, you know, kind of short, a little less clothing, hanging out with cars, late in the evening, you're outside, doors are open. I think it's going to be more of a, more of a, that feel. I was worried too late in the year about weather, so. I might draw a few more cars because they'll like to get them out in fair weather. So
there'll be mosquitoes the size of bald eagles.
They carry off long. They carry off
they
small
carry
children.
Off kids.
Yeah, skeeter eaters, man. That's, yeah, we do have a few bugs in Missouri. I've never seen any place that has this many bugs, but we got them. So
when I first came back Cape, that's what I looked at. I said, man, they ought to quit growing this rice and soybeans and cotton and grow bugs.
Well, I would. Yeah,
they
I would
raise about 1,200 pounds an acre, I believe.
I hadn't been here.
Put them in a little sack, send them to California and sell them as like organic garden amendments or something.
Well, I drove down to through south down here one evening. It was by Duck Creek or whatever. And the bugs were hitting the windshield so hard, I had to turn on the windshield wipers. And that is not an exaggeration. I had to turn on the fluid and the windshield wipers because they were just creaming my windshield. So we don't want to scare anybody off. We do have off.
Yeah, they'll be streaming in for it now, Richard.
Yeah, we do have off in this area. So.
Let's make it a short one this week.
Let's do it. Let's get home.
Stay with us. Come back next week.
Let's
we'll try again.
Okay.